So this time around in lecture 9, we're going to be talking about vectors. Some of this is a review. We've covered raster versus vector before and back in earlier on our Photoshop module. But I wanted to hit it again. These are actually the exact same slides and bullet points from that lecture. But it's important to review this as a recap of what you just covered with raster editing and what the unique differences are with vector editing. So in vector graphics, the images are made up of lines and curves, similar to what you did in geometry as a high school student. Maybe you plot a point on a graph and plot another point on that graph and then draw a line between those two. At its very simplest definition, that's what Illustrator is doing. You're adding points and connecting those with paths or line segments and combining those over and over repeatedly into more complex shapes to create art, basically. So it's a way of illustrating. You're not drawing with a pen or a pencil necessarily, but you're connecting the dots to make whatever you want. And I'll show you some samples to give you an idea that there are really limitless ways to use Illustrator and create quite amazing pieces of artwork. So raster graphics, as we know, are good for things that have pixels, continuous tone images like photographs. Problems are that it is resolution dependent. We have limitations on how much we can scale it up. If we're going to make a raster graphic bigger, then we have to add more pixels, and those pixels have to come from somewhere. Photoshop or whatever program we're using is going to guess, and some of the time, as long as we're not scaling it up too much, it's going to do a pretty good job. But at some point, we're going to get degraded image quality as a result, because those pixels, as good as Photoshop is, just pulling them out of thin air based on available information in your file is only going to get you so far. Vector graphics, on the other hand, are great for line art because you can resize them as much as you want. Really, all you're doing is increasing the scale of your graph. Take those two points that we talked about on the last slide, increase the distance between those two, you have a longer line. You didn't have to make new pixels or anything like that. It's still just as smooth and as crisp of a line. It's just longer. So the differences are positive in terms of resolution, simplicity of the graphics, and what they can be used for. The file size is great. They're good for things with line art in them, but it's difficult to use with things that have a continuous tone. And again, I'll show you some samples to illustrate this point a little bit more later on. So hopefully you all remember this. We saw this graphic before. This is just a simple demonstration of a vector circle versus a raster circle. I recommend that you try this out. Make one in Photoshop with the paintbrush tool. Just make a dot. Zoom way in on that thing to 3200% or whatever it takes until you can see those pixels. And it's very easily and readily apparent that it is rasterized. There's going to be visual pixels making up that dot. And if you scale it up bigger and bigger, you're going to lose image quality. Vector graphics, on the other hand, just go into there and make a vector circle in Illustrator, and you're going to get beautiful results. Okay, here's some examples. So first off, clip art. Clip art's a very simple use for Illustrator, and there's all kinds of things that you can make with clip art, from simple examples like the bottom right-hand side, these universal symbols that you see leading to stairs or to a bathroom or drinking fountain, that sort of thing. Pretty straightforward and easy to understand how you'd make those in Illustrator, I hope. They're very basic shapes, just silhouettes of some very abstract people. Moving on, you have logos of sports teams or logos of businesses or whatever else, app icons, emojis, clip art, like those construction vehicles and things like that. So they can be very detailed. They can be very simple. There's a lot of room for everything in between. There are countless examples. I tried to narrow it down to just some things that would kind of illustrate exactly what you can do with vector art. But here's some other ones. Again, this is just from an internet search, some things that caught my eye. The Lego movie, for example, here was a 3D rendered movie. It would be very easy for them to create a 3D poster. This one is a 2D artwork. with a 3D appearance, kind of a fake 3D using perspective art, but it's done as an illustration, and you can see that really easily in the colors and the lines and things like that. The Little Mermaid one, also, that's an illustration. This is a fairly good execution of a concept movie poster for The Little Mermaid, and I like these, so I pulled a couple more of these Disney illustrated poster ideas that someone has made, just to drive home the point of some of the things that you can do with Illustrator. And again, just look around on image search on Google for a little while, and you're going to find tons of Illustrator examples. Just search for vector movie posters, for example, and you'll see all kinds of cool stuff out there that people have done with Illustrator. I've got a couple of posters hanging in my office that are Illustrator works, and they're for different bands and things like that. And they're just amazing, the talent that people have creating this stuff. So the tool is not a limitation. The fact that you don't have a continuous tone brush isn't really a limitation. There is so much that you can do with these tools. And I'll show you on the next few slides what I mean. So those look like photographs on the top. Those two renderings of a French horn and a water faucet or shower or whatever that is. You can see the wireframes on the bottom. Those are the vector wireframes, or meshes is what they're called, that are used to illustrate that. So those two objects, as organic and reflective as they look, are actually done using paths and fills and gradients in those. So very complex stuff done with Illustrator, which you'd think, and again, this is time consuming. That takes a lot of work to have that level of detail to make it look photorealistic. But the point is that it is definitely possible. When you look at something like this, you realize that, wow, there are some people who have way too much free time on their hands because of the level of complexity in this vector art is insane. That's not a photograph. That's a vector illustration. And you can see the wireframe example right there that proves the point. Right here, another one. Top is the original photo. The bottom is the resulting vector illustration. And then there's the wireframe mesh on the left. So we're not going to get into this level of complexity with our illustrations in this class. Don't worry, we're not going to go that far along. But just to show that there is potential for everything from the simplest little bathroom signs with silhouettes of stick figure people up to photorealistic renderings of portraits, objects, machines, vehicles, all kinds of stuff. So at this point, we have an advanced Photoshop class. We don't have an advanced Illustrator class, but if you want to take it a step further, there are tons of resources available that take you beyond what we cover in this class. We're going to get the basics of navigating the interface, using the tools that are available to you at a basic level so that everybody's kind of competent with it. And then from there, you can find tons of resources on lynda.com, various books, just simple videos on YouTube. There's a ton of education that you can get for free right there on YouTube, and places like creativelive.com and others. So be sure to keep an eye out for this sort of stuff. If it's something that you're interested in, feel free to reach out and ask, and I can happily give you more resources on learning more about illustration.